And on Hot Copy this morning, we have attorney Howard Calleja, one of the lawyers who filed the petition against the anti-terror law. Good morning to you, attorney Calleja.
Good morning, Karen. Good morning sa inyong mga televiewers. Good morning.
All right. Attorney Calleja, you are now at the Supreme Court. I know that over the weekend, you filed the petition digitally. Just take us through what you will be going through today.
Yes, Karen, I'm also happy to announce that last night, yesterday actually, we received an email from the Supreme Court acknowledging our electronic filing. So technically, they have received our acknowledged receipt of our filing yesterday or Saturday. And today, what we are doing, we are bringing the 15 copies, physical copies of the of our petition, 66-page petition, to the Supreme Court together with the CD and file the appropriate filing fees and make sure that every process or procedure into filing is done and completed today.
Okay. Now, this July, the law essentially takes into effect. Is it possible to expect the Supreme Court to act before it takes into effect?
Part of our petition, Karen, is a prayer for temporary restraining order or status quo ante or any reliefs to stop or to temporarily stop the implementation of this anti-terror act. So we hope and pray, and we pray for the independence of this this court, that it will be given due force and that it would be allowed its proper time to be ventilated. In that matter, we hope that our TRO would be given order or be granted. Otherwise, of course, we call this a very tyrannical and oppressive law. We don't know what's going to happen after July 19th.
All right. Take us through some of the elements in the law that you're questioning. You've said there are many constitutional infirmities with the anti-terror law. Let's start first with you want to question Section 3, 4, 5, 9, 10, all the way down to technically Section 54. But take us some, some of your main points, attorney.
Well, basically, if you see 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, those are the definitions or being talked about the vagueness of the law, because you have to know what are you charged of. In reading the law, we don't know what we are charged of. Yes, they say terrorism, but who will define the terrorism? That's why you have Section 54, which is the Anti-Terrorism Council. They cannot define that because they are not the court. The court, our courts under our law, because we have three different branches of government, that is the only one that defines or can tell you who is a terrorist or terrorist group. They can identify you. But however, if you look at Section 29, it allows the police officers to take you into custody, detain you for 14 days plus another 10 days upon only a notice from the ATC. So that's the question. It's a warrantless arrest upon tagging of the ATC on mere suspicion. So, and nobody can question about that. We agree that there are cases of warrantless arrest that is allowed, but it's only allowed when an actual crime is being committed. Here, even on the intent, even on a notice, even on a suspicion, you can be arrested and there would be no case filed to you within 14 days or an extended of 10 days, so that's a total of 24 days, and we don't know what's going to happen. And there's no judicial recourse within that period. Even if they say that they inform you, the courts will not do anything. They will just know that you are there, but they cannot release you within those 10 or 14 days.
Okay. Now, is Section 29 misunderstood? I interviewed Senator Ping Lacson. I also interviewed Congresswoman Lucy Torres Gomez. And they said that Section 29 is commonly misunderstood. They claim that at the end of the day, when it's a warrantless arrest, it still doesn't violate the conditions under Rule 113 on the conditions where one can conduct a warrantless arrest, and the ATC's role when it designates to arrest a suspected terrorist is only under or when there's hot pursuit. Is that clear to you, attorney?
Those are interpretations, Karen. That's precisely another issue. So it's subject to whoever's interpretation. But I have been teaching statutory construction or how to understand the law. Even a layman, if you read Section 25, it's very clear. It is you can, upon notice of the ATC, the officers can put you into custody into 14 days plus another 10 days. There's no other explanation to that. It is very clear. So what are we arguing about? That's why we're saying, well, that's why we are here, Karen, because with that fear, no, anybody can be arrested, just like you. You're a journalist. Another chilling effect here is the freedom of speech. So if you say something like President X, Y, and Z, I don't like his face because he doesn't do well, they can say that that is a terrorist act, and they can even bring it to detention just for saying that.
Okay, but advocates of the bill, Attorney Calleja, have also argued that there's no violation when it comes to the Bill of Rights. Are they correct, or is that another interpretation?
That's a totally wrong interpretation. That is our view. If you read our petition, there are many unconstitutional provisions. To us, that it is vague and void from the very start, void on its face. Because just like what we discussed on the warrantless arrest and the prolonged detention of 10 and 14 days, 24 to be exact, that is totally against our constitution. The constitution only allows at maximum of 3 days without being charged. Here, you are being charged, you are being detained 24 days without being charged. So that is precisely one of the things that we are really objecting to. And as I said, it is that is already a overbreath of the responsibilities of the judiciary, because only the judge or only our judges can give a warrantless arrest. And under our law, if you look at Section 29 of this code, it says that irrespective of Section 135. So that in itself disregards the provisions of prolonged detention and on warrantless arrest. So I cannot see how they would like to interpret it, but precisely the point, Karen, if it's subject to many interpretations, that's why we are here. We are making sure that it would be interpreted in the correct way, taking in mind the Constitution, because under our law, the final interpreter of our laws is the Supreme Court.
Okay. Now, the authors of the law have also said that when you look at the anti-terror bill, they put in safeguards. Once a suspected terrorist is arrested, the law enforcers have to even inform the nearest judge. Without a lawyer, they have to call the free legal assistance for the suspect to make sure that he or she has a lawyer with him. So they've also claimed that they've put on several safeguards under the law, including a section that no torture can be conducted, etc., etc.
Karen, all those safeguards are in our constitution. That's why we are here. We cannot take away the constitution. They cannot say that they put those safeguards, because the safeguards itself is the constitution. Mm-hmm. If we do away with the constitution, if you violate the constitution, then we are violating the safeguard. If they're saying that you are going to report to the judge or to your lawyer, I would ask them this. The judge doesn't have a jurisdiction over the subject matter, because there is no case filed. It's only an information that somebody is in jail. The court doesn't have jurisdiction over the person, because the person is not surrendered to the court. So what case or what would the court do? Nothing. The court cannot do anything, because he has no jurisdiction of that person being detained. So even if you inform, even if you just inform them, that is only what they can do, just an information, just a knowledge that you are there. But for 24 days, you are locked up without any crime, without any basis, and without any hope of being released within those 24 days. Who do I go to be released in 24 days? Nobody. It doesn't say. Because the court cannot, as I said, cannot even release you, because it does not have jurisdiction over you.
Okay. Now, what if they argue, Attorney Calleja, that it's also quite clear in the anti-terror law, Section 4, that actually states that This is not meant to silence critics of the administration, and even enumerates acts that don't violate essentially freedom of speech, even mass rallies. There is a caveat, of course, some lawyers have said, but authors may argue, isn't that clear, Section 4, that it's not meant to silence dissent against the government?
But who will decide that, Karen? We're saying that those should be decided by the court. Mm. It's the ATC who decides that. What if the ATC gives a notice and saying your rally is against? Even if I say it is not against or under the provision, those provisions of those safeguards, if the ATC says, no, you are wrong, then what is my recourse? As I said, then I'll be detained again for 24 days or 10 days or 14 days. Depends on what they want. That's the point there, Karen. It is there. But that is also in the Constitution. We don't even have to put it there. Because if they only respect the Constitution, then this would have no problem.
Okay.
We are saying, Karen, that I understand that we need a terror bill, that we need a terror act, but not in the way it is written. Mm-hmm. I'm saying we should rewrite it properly to be consistent with the Constitution, to be consistent with the rule of law.
Okay. Now, Attorney Calleja, you also have supporters of the bill that may argue that the ATC has already existed in the Human Security Act of 2007, and that was not declared to be unconstitutional. Why would you be optimistic that the Supreme Court may see this differently, considering supporters have said that Section 18 of the Human Security Act in 2007 was controversial, no less than Attorney Harry Roque said that, and yet it did not prosper in the Supreme Court?
Yes, but as I said, in this law, if you look at it, it is totally different from the Human Security Act. Mm. There are many provisions, as I said, on its face that are void from the very start. Mm-mm. That should not even be there. That's Mm-mm. why we're saying we are up for the challenge, Karen. If Harry Roque says there's a controversial provision, that's okay. That's why we are here. We are going to fight it out in the best way, in the best forum possible, for that everybody would know, every issues would be threshed out. And as I said, we are not fighting for me, for you, but we are fighting for everybody and for your parents, your children's children, and their children, because this would be something that would last for the Philippines for a long time.
Attorney Howie, surveillance as a requisite is also a contentious part of the anti-terror law. The old law only allows an ATC-authorized arrest and detention if it results from surveillance under Section 7 and examination of bank deposits under Section 27 of this Act. And yet this new law has a completely more liberal, right? Is that fair to say?
It is more liberal and it extends to more than 60 days.
Yeah.
So technically, we call this a witch hunt. So if you really have evidence, then there's no reason why you have to make a long surveillance or get them without any due process. That's what we're saying. Due process is a cornerstone of our Constitution. What we are fighting here is due process, rule of law, and consistency with the Constitution. We are not fighting the government, because we are saying that this law should stand this government and the next government and the next generation. Mm-mm. So that's why we are here, Karen. We are fighting for the basic laws of the country, which is the Constitution, and the basic principle, which is the rule of law and due process.
Okay. All right. Now, Attorney Calleja, I know Senator Kiko Pangilinan also wants to file a petition before the Supreme Court. I'm sure there are many other groups who want to do this. What are your thoughts on so many petitions? Would you want to come together as one group? How would this work?
Yes, yes, Karen. There will, by experience, they would combine all of these cases together and then hear it all at the same time. So we don't have the monopoly of knowledge. All lawyers, all well-meaning Filipinos are welcome to challenge this law. That is our right. That's why we are here. We are not going to the streets or going anywhere. We are coming here to the proper forum to ventilate our rights and to ventilate the issues so that it would be heard properly. And we are here, and I see other petitioners might be here also. And I mean, it's welcome. It's good for our country that everybody would be heard.
Okay. Now, what is the track record of the track record of the Supreme Court historically in declaring that a law that's been passed, signed by the president, is unconstitutional? I mean, in recent history, the most glaring was the MOA AD. But is there any other?
Well, if you look at it, it can be held constitutional in some parts or unconstitutional in some parts. All I'm saying, a lot of people are even saying, this is a Duterte court, it's all one-sided. But what I am saying, Karen, is this is an independent court. The judiciary is an independent branch of the government. Whatever experience before, whatever track record they have before, all we are saying is we have to abide with the decision of the court being the last arbiter of our land. And we are confident that the court will be independent, the justices will be independent, and will rise to the occasion to defend the Republic and the Constitution.
All right. Well, on that note, I want to thank you so much, Attorney Howie Calleja, for joining us this morning. I know you're quite busy. Your hands are full over there. Thank you so much, Attorney. Appreciate
it
very much.
Thank you, Karen, and pray for us and wish us luck.
All right.